Oh, fuck. It's another Down With Boring.
Straight in with the swear words. And I'm trying to get us on BBC Radio 1.
We're trying to just dive in with the expletives so people know what's to come on this show. By this point, if you've been a regular listener, I don't think you should be surprised, is what I would say.
We are attracting new listeners by the day, though. I think we've got about 6 million now. I haven't got any facts to back that up. But anecdotally, I have actually met 2 people that have listened to an episode. So extrapolating that across the UK, big numbers.
I have met people.
Welcome back to Down With Boring, everyone.
Yes, welcome. It's great to be here another time, another week.
I've just cut you off there, so you just said, I've met people.
To confirm, we are actually people outside of what you hear through your ears. We are human beings, so it's delightful to be here.
We are.
How are you doing, Jake?
A bit of housekeeping from us. This is a normal show.
This is.
And then we've basically got our classic sort of sporadic summertime. So we'll be popping up here and there, doing various bits and pieces at festivals and stuff. But other than that, we are going to be on a rough hiatus from now until, I guess, September for normal shows.
From normal shows. We're still going to be here. You'll be hearing from us every couple of weeks.
I think basically like it's going to be a similar like level of output, but there's going to be... There might be 3 weeks between a couple of shows rather than 2, but we're not going to abandon you, don't worry.
If you're livid about the fact that you don't get tweets of the week, you're going to hate the next few months, because it's mainly going to be us in various forms at various events, chatting to various artists. So stick around for that over the summer. What summer to come, Jake? What a wonderful time to come, lies Jake. Ahead of us, including Dork's Day Out, which is returning. Saturday the 3rd of August at the world famous Signature Brew in Black Horse
world
Road.
Famous.
I mean, by this
says
point,
who?
Well, I'm saying it now, you know, if you ask someone who maybe is in France, who maybe lived in North London, they'll know it. That counts as world famous.
True.
That counts.
That's true.
We'll be back on the 3rd of August. Line up to be announced.
Have we got our own business. Beer this time, or did we ruin it so badly last time they haven't invited us to do another
one? I think that the stock is still somewhere in the brewery. Anyone from Signature Brew listening can confirm that to us. There will be some there. So, yes, for all of you who are fans of Down With Pouring, don't you worry. It'll be there, I'm sure.
A refreshing rattler from the people that brought you Tweets of the Week.
If you can imagine this show as a drink, it's that. I'll leave that up to you exactly how you want to perceive that. But it's there.
I think that's offensive to the drink, but yeah.
Yeah, apologies for Signature Brew for that one. But we'll see you there. A full day of live favourites, all in the heart of London, all for a very reasonable price too, can I flag? So pick up your tickets now.
Could I possibly flag the reasonable price?
Deals, and deals. So Go and pick up a ticket with more lineup news to come. So keep an eye on the Dork website and socials for all of that and more. When we're recording this,
there's more, Jamie.
There is more. I'm just saying, when we're recording this, when you listen to this, obviously, we'll have just finished up a really busy weekend of various Dork Live activities, including tonight as we record this. Pale Waves at the 100 Club in London. Thanks to everyone who came. This is hoping that everyone turns up. So I hope you do.
I mean, I feel like it might be quite a busy one.
I feel like it's going to be quite a busy one.
Any worries on that front?
Yes. And also we'll have just been at Dot to Dot as well. So if you were there, thanks. I'm speaking in the future, Jake. It's quite mad, isn't it, all of this?
Feels like a sci-fi movie, doesn't it?
Like Alien, except we're
just like that.
We're bursting out of your chest with music news and knowledge.
What was that Christopher Nolan one that was something about time travel, but not really? But also, someone moved a book around from space to tell his daughter he loved her, or something.
Was that Inception? Inception, is that the one?
Interstellar. Inception's about dreams, isn't it? They're all in the dreams, and then they're in more dreams,
and then more dreams,
and in some other dreams.
And then you don't know
the thing is,
at
the end, you don't know whether they're still in a dream. But I got around that because I didn't actually care. So
you got to the end and went, cool, Is that your movie watching experience?
Trick is they're not either in a dream or not in a dream. They're actors.
I bet you're fucking great fun at like a film festival. So like this is all like fake, right?
No, I've never been invited. Yeah. Never
surprisingly,
been invited to one.
Surprisingly, we haven't gone to any. Much like that, we look into the future. Come along to a show. It's going to be nice.
Please.
Should we move on to some? Some news. Speaking of,
what about truck?
Oh yeah, what's happening at truck, Jake?
Oh, I can't believe you're going to make me talk about it out loud. This is like when I feel like the kid in school that says, like, "Oh, you forgot to take in the homework,"
and you're like, "Go on then."
We're at truck festival.
Yeah, we are.
Didn't we already say this? We put it in the plan, but we've definitely already said it.
It's repeating to the listeners that we're doing this.
You didn't give me any stage directions. We're still heading to Truck Festival this summer. We're still giving a specially curated lineup, and we're still going to take over the nest.
Yeah. There you go. Be there. Pick up a ticket.
28th of July.
Yep.
Bob Villain, personal trainer, Artworms, Mary in the Junkyard, and of course, Pittlepunk Pioneers, Velour.
Oh, what a time. I can't think of a better Sunday. Just saying.
Okay. What about basking in the ever-loving praise of our Lord Jesus Christ?
Jesus Christ has never, you know, made a Pittlepunk anthem, though. So
that's true. I cannot disagree.
And so until he does that, he's not getting on the lineup. Sorry for anyone looking out for Jesus Christ on any future lineup. But
okay,
it's not happening.
That seems fair.
So if you're a fan of live music and indie and big festival weekends, we'll see you there. If you're exclusively a fan of Jesus and that's what you're there for, we can't deliver that.
Yeah, big mistake.
But equally as spiritual an experience, maybe. Depends how big your weekend goes.
It's funny because both Jamie and I, when we recorded this, were like, oh, we should probably do this one quickly because we don't have much time and we're 7.5 minutes in and we're talking about Jesus.
We're chatting shit.
We haven't even started doing the news yet.
Music news, shall we, Jake? What's been going on in the world in the past few weeks?
The Ivan Novello's happened.
What is the Ivan Novello's for people who maybe aren't aware? It's kind of like it's aimed at like songwriting in particular, I feel.
It's just an award show, but it's quite a prestigious one because it's specifically awarded to a songwriter. So this one was presented by Paul McCartney. Mm. So you know that's pretty big, isn't it?
Yeah, I reckon Paul McCartney does stuff. He presented the very special international award. Presenting the Fellow of the Ivers Academy, which you know,
that's big moves. Right. Yes,
and
of
who
course.
Did it? Who
the
did
big
it go
one.
To, Jake? What upstart?
I don't know. I basically just watched like 3 Instagram stories from CMAT and thought it'd be good to include. So
it went to Bruce Springsteen. That's what happened.
Of course.
He picked up the award for an international fellow.
That would explain what I'm currently reading. I see. So this is interesting. So Paul McCartney gave it to Bruce Springsteen.
Yeah.
Bruce Springsteen came on stage. They're obviously mates. And Paul McCartney basically made fun of how long his concerts were.
Yeah.
Then said he couldn't think of anyone better before naming loads of other people that should have won it instead. And then said Bruce Springsteen's never worked a day in his life. That's awful. That's a terrible... Like, I don't care whether you're friends, mate. That's horrible.
But
like, congratulations, you fucking layabout who doesn't deserve this. Stop playing for so long.
Is it kind of like... It feels like it's more of a roast than it is actually an award show, you know?
Yeah, like he's misunderstood like what this is.
It's like a best man speech at a wedding and he's kind of just gone, and this guy's a real piece of shit. Anyway, well done, mate. Congratulations. Have a wonderful time.
Yeah, well done. Big fan of all you do.
All that you do.
So, yeah.
Yeah. A lot of winners,
though.
That
was good.
A lot of winners. Lana Del Rey picked up an award. Ray.
Ray, of course, who seems to have, too many awards for a mantelpiece now.
Yeah. Like, you're going to need a big mantle. How big can you make a mantelpiece? And I also feel like, are mantelpieces going out of like fashion? I feel like a mantelpiece in like 30 years ago.
I wouldn't have one installed if I didn't have one.
You've so like, got it with the home.
I don't know how many new ones are getting installed.
It came
as part of the home.
Yeah, maybe more of a cabinet.
Probably quite petty to take it with you when you leave a place, isn't it?
I'm going to take the TV, this furniture's ours, and I'm going to be honest, that mantelpiece is great, so I'm going to have that as well. Just chipping it out the wall, just banging 10 nils out of it.
Yeah, I'm not sure if ours is, like, weirdly ours is quite heavy, but then I went to like clean it and it just sort of moved a bit, so I do worry. Alarm. I don't get too close to it. Anyway, the Ivan Novello's happened. CMAT didn't win.
No.
So we're going to play Our Shoot by CMAT because it's a song that sounds like what you'd say when you don't win. Right?
Right, yeah. Congratulations to CMAT. You didn't win, but you won. You're always a winner to us. Is that a good thing? Is that something
exactly.
to me? That's something
if
good?
I was Ivor and Jamie was Novello, you would have won.
Yeah, would have been no question. It would have been there for you. I also just a big fan
Springsteen
of...
Springsteen hit the road.
A big fan of CMAT just enjoying red carpet era CMAT. It's a real good time that we fully back. And was in the works really from... the very first moment ever chatted.
I think there is something to be said for like celebrities don't enjoy celebrity stuff enough. Like, you know, when people like the general thing is red carpet events and stuff like that. It's like, mate, like just go out there and just be fucking ludicrous. Like, why not? like, you know what I mean? Like, if someone put me on the red carpet and they ask weirdly like banal questions, you would literally just be like, what the fuck is going on? This is strange.
Fucking let's go for it. Where it's like, oh man, I've got another awards due and I've got really fancy dinner I've got to go to, and I've just got to go to this event.
It's like the classic thing with the Met Gala, right, where it's like, what do they do when they're in there? And I think they just like get changed into normal clothes and then have dinner, which is incredibly funny as a thing.
Well, yeah, because the Met Gala, like, what's the point of it? Am I missing a point
it's
of
to
it?
It's for charity, but the charity's really funny.
Is it charity?
The charity is literally like to raise money for the Metropolitan Museum of Art Costume Institute.
So what?
Yeah, so like it just raises money for like a museum of costumes.
I guess it's a cause. Nothing against that
institute, but it is like, I feel like there's bigger stuff, right?
We could divert this fund somewhere else, maybe. Shout out the Met Gala, I guess, on that note. fuck me. I've got more good news, though, for you, Jake, so we don't have to worry about whether, you know, the fashion department at the local university have got enough money to, you know, make some outfits. And that is that Beabadoobee is back and has announced a brand new album, which is very... very good indeed. It's called This Is How Tomorrow Moves. It's Beabadoobee's third album. In a statement, Beabadoobee said, and wait for it, I love this album.
What, to the police?
I love this album. I feel like it's helped me so much more than anything else has in navigating this new era, this new understanding of where I'm at. I guess it's about becoming a woman. So an album...
Aside from the bit about becoming a woman, that's what I say when I'm hungover and someone gets me a Diet Coke.
It's helped me more than anything in navigating this new era, this new understanding of where I'm at.
Yeah.
I can feel it. I can feel that 100%. Oh, fuck.
You know, sometimes these things, you just need them. That's very good news. Beabadoobee's great, obviously.
Yes.
New music's great. So new music from Beabadoobee.
Beatopia was the last album out in 2022. We talked about on the show. Really big fans of. Obviously, has been on the cover of this here magazine to mark it all. Really looking forward to it. I think Beabadoobee continues to grow and grow into an artist that, like, just every single step is like feels natural, but also just feels elevated. Like, it's a weird thing just to say, oh yeah, that's an understandable growth, but like, that's what kind of Beabadoobee is doing, and it's sounding amazing. And with it, we've got
it
a new
feels
trend.
Like, there's nothing she can't Beabadoo.
New track called Take a Bite has come with this news, so we're gonna play that right now. Take a bite. Wonderful stuff. Beabadoobee. Back.
Huge news.
The album's out August the 16th, by the way. We didn't actually mention that. Is that enough time? Is that enough time for you, Jake? Is that a nice running?
That's about right, I'd say.
Great. Perfect. Approved. Beabadoobee. Yeah. Approved.
More huge news. Ross Atkins, the BBC newsreader, is DJing Glastonbury.
Not the creator of the Atkins diet, I presume. In any
could
form.
Be. They haven't mentioned that, though.
Ooh,
so like weirdly, they've said he's baby. Known yeah. for his explainer videos, which is funny because, like...
Isn't like, that what a newsreader should be doing anyway, I would
well,
presume?
Yeah, I know they do have a specific explainer thing, but it's funny that, like, he's become the guy. Must be really annoying if you're on, like, a night out and someone sees you and they're like, oh, I've always wondered, can you explain to me the difference between, like, you know, gin and vodka or something?
Yeah. What, and does like an 8 minute video.
Like, is he going to be DJing or is he going to explain each song before he does it? Also, what's he going to DJ? Like, it's so weird. He's just sort of said, like, it's frankly incomprehensible that I'm tweeting this.
Yeah.
What started off with a one-off drum and bass set for Six Music 2 years ago has ended up here, which is such a funny thing for a man who's like a high-profile newsreader to say.
So they're
like, you're right out there reading the news every day, and you're saying it's incomprehensible that you, a man who can DJ drum and bass, is going to DJ drum and bass.
It's maybe not as shocking as you probably would think. Bearing in mind also, as backstory, Ross Atkins, the newsreader, he did have a career as a DJ in Brixton for a brief period.
So
he was a DJ there, but then he obviously left to read news and that.
It's like if Ludacris was reading BBC News one day and he said, "This is incredible. Ever since my 5-year stint as a newsreader for the BBC, I never could have believed that this would happen to me."
It's like, he does have history. It's okay. Okay, yeah, joining a lineup on that Stonebridge stage, which also includes, you know, real mixture. You know, Idris Elba is one personal favourite, Annie Mac, and then obviously Ross Atkins from BBC News.
I do think, like, if you go and see Ross Atkins instead of going to do anything else at Glastonbury, like, you are probably a bit of a flannel. Nothing against the man, but like, it's not like when the Chuckle Brothers did it and it was like, that's good stuff. There's no one ever who's going to be impressed by, like, if you went to see Idris Elba, people would be like, oh, that's funny. Yeah. If you went, I went to see Ross Atkins DJ, they'd be like, oh, who's that? And you'd be like, oh, you know the guy on the BBC that does those explainer videos?
You'd
have to explain the explainer.
Yeah, after a while, you're done. It's just kind of like, reminds me of the other DJ's like set that stood out from announcements this year, which was Gary Neville. The football pundit and football legend who is DJing at a festival this year as well. These are the steps which electronic music has been waiting for, I feel. You know, this is it.
I agree.
And they can play alongside such DJs as DJ Die, which is actually one of the persons playing on this stage at Glastonbury. So
great. One of the great stuff.
It's the great stuff too.
We're going to play a song now. We're not going to play drum and bass.
We're not.
Probably be a bit much. We're going to speak to Good Neighbours after this. So we thought, no drum and bass. So instead we've gone for a mellow trance classic. This is Darude with Sandstorm. We'll be right back.
are.
Yeah.
It is a lovely summer's day. The sun is here.
It is.
It was raining earlier, but now it's shining bright.
This is Down With Boring, which you're listening to right now. Welcome back, everyone. We are here with the wonderful Good Neighbours. I don't know why Jamie opened with a weather report. How are you doing, guys?
Very good.
Good. Happy to be in sunny Brighton.
Yeah, a lovely day, a lovely time. It feels like a very busy period for you guys. A lot kind of like going on and kind of, I guess, getting that live show out there to all sorts of places and stuff. Like, how's it kind of feeling, really, in your world?
It's been nice just to actually like see everything happen in the flesh now. So obviously when it all took off for us, it was very much like everything was coming through on our phones, like, oh my God, you're getting played on Radio 1, or like,
hit this like a little message that comes through.
But it kind of felt like a game that we were just doing really well at. And then now we start to play shows and seeing people like sing the song back. And
you're like, there's actually, there they are.
So cool. Yeah. Yeah, so good.
It's not just stats. There's
not
actually
just
people.
Bots. Yeah.
Exactly. Yeah. And I guess kind of for you guys as well, kind of like seeing this all kind of grow over the past few months and kind of everything as well. Like, how has that been, almost being at the center of that and being like seeing this all kind of like build around you? Like, how's that been?
Yeah, it's been pretty mental. I mean, like, we've waited a long time for it to happen, so we're just like, letting it all do its thing. Yeah.
It's kind of imposter syndrome, but also kind of like we've earned it, which is nice.
Yeah.
We're quite jaded.
Like, there is a lot going on, but we also have only played like 4 or 5 shows, so it feels
quite early to be jaded about it all. But I guess get it.
I think
early,
more jaded mentally. No, we're excited.
We were like that before we started the band.
Yeah, true.
Yeah, exactly. Because obviously you guys have been making music in various forms for like a number of years now, and kind of like seeing this kind of come together as well, like, was there kind of like that moment where you were like, oh, okay, we've got something here? Like, do you see that from kind of like an early stage, or was it something that kind of, I don't know, it's kind of been
honestly
building?
Honestly, not really. Like, I don't think we were like, we've got something. So we did it as like almost like a bit of a writing exercise just while we were hanging out last year, and then came over a few songs that we were super happy with, and almost we're using it more as a hangout
between
writing for other people and stuff. And when we eventually played it to like a couple of close mates, they were very like taken aback and were like, why are you not releasing it? So then we committed and we're like, okay, well, actually, we'll call this a band.
Yeah. We'll make it something.
Begrudgingly doing it, but then we're so happy we did it because
like, I guess we'll do this.
It's literally changed our lives.
Just like, I guess we'll go and do this.
Very British.
And I'll be more like, you'll be more like, sorry, why don't you react like this to all the other songs that like you know we've been making separately? Like, it's a bit weird. Like, how about that? To be fair,
it's a weird DNA that we've got going.
Exactly, and it must be nice as well, kind of like obviously putting that out and seeing, you know, the reaction, how it kind of just obviously just exploded. Kind of like everywhere. Like, would you kind of remember like that moment where you looked and you were like, oh, this is kind of gone big and I didn't know this was going to happen?
I remember it pretty clearly because we were away writing in Somerset, like just me and Ollie. And then we just like gone to meet some friends and then had like an hour off our phone, and it was like in that hour they just like
it went crazy.
Went nuts.
We'd had like a few thousand like hits on TikTok, which for us at the time was amazing.
Yeah, you're like, well, here we go.
Because we literally just had radio silence. And then, we all went for breakfast. And then when we came out of it, it was like 100,000, which we were already losing our minds at. And then, like, by the time we got to the car, it was 10 minutes away. It was like 400,000. And we're like, what is happening? Is this viral?
Is this for real? Is this you like ringing someone up? Like, I think our TikTok's broken.
Oh, no, honestly, we called our manager and we're like, I don't know what's happening, but I think we're going viral. And it's literally two boys that just don't use TikTok.
I love that. I also love just the idea of the two of you just being like, there's so many other explanations. They can't be that we're actually popular.
I have a great picture of like Ollie on that walk to the car, just like jumping for joy.
Oh, yeah.
The moment we checked.
That is nice.
I love that, because you're saying about sometimes, I remember, they're like, I don't know, it was kind of like a slow build. I love that you're like, yeah, we were having breakfast. I actually remember the hour it happened.
So good.
Exactly happened. And I guess, you know, obviously like beyond kind of like home and everything, kind of now like obviously like next steps for like you guys, especially like I guess playing live, what's it been like to kind of show, I guess, to everyone like this collection of songs that you have as well?
It's been like a live sounding board, to be honest. So like when we're playing the songs live, obviously I always preface it like, you've never heard any of these songs, which is nice.
I was at the Lexington gig where you're like, so we're gonna play one that you know. And you won't know any of the others.
Yeah.
And it feels rubbish because then you feel like you're just selling them a dream. But like, it's been really good to like songs that we love. And maybe they perform really well, or maybe it's a different song that like we never even thought about. Next release, for example.
Yeah.
I don't know if I can name names yet on it, but it's coming out fairly soon.
It's a song that's coming out soon.
One that when we played it live, everyone came up to us and was like, that last song.
Yeah.
Which for me, like, you loved it, but I never like loved it. I just thought it's a good one. And then when people start coming up, you're like, ah, this is what I can use now. Like, it's a really good tool.
Yeah, exactly. And kind of like to showcase that a little bit more. Like, and is it very much so when you've kind of like, right, we've got everything almost ready. We've got this idea of like what's to come. And now, like, do you kind of have that clear sort of like ambition in mind? Or like, I mean, judging from this, it's like, we can't really believe this is happening.
So the general mood here is just the sort, I love the sort of amusement that like every gig you feel like someone's going to go, oh, it was all a sham. Then they really liked it, and then it was really big, which was really strange.
It does feel a lot like, even just like in the recordings and stuff, it's like the drums are all iPhone mics and stuff, and then when you hear it on like a stage, not stadium, but on like massive speakers,
it is really funny.
That shouldn't be iPhone playing out there.
This shouldn't be happening.
They played in like a Crystal Palace football club the other day, which we have no affiliation to.
I love that. Yeah, I want to just flag right away. Yeah, we are not
affiliated. But they were playing it, and I was like, that is really funny because it's just like going out to thousands of people and then throwing back to me and Scott just like putting iPhones in like inside a kick drum.
Yeah. You're like, you're like, really playing this?
Yeah, just be like, no one's going to hear this.
Yeah, no one's going to hear it. I guess that was it as well. Like you say, you were creating kind of stuff like just together, as like just hanging out and stuff like that. Like, those kind of like, I guess, early tracks, I guess, you were just like, we're just making this for fun. Like,
truly.
Yeah.
And like, weirdly, I was talking to my friend the other day and he was like, what do you like most about Good Neighbours as opposed to other things that I've worked on in music? And I was like, it's just the fact that we've never tried once. And for some reason, that's annoying because that's so obvious from an outside perspective. So like, don't feed the audience, feed yourselves. And if they like it, they like it.
Yeah.
But
I think that's also something that you hear bands say a lot, but it still feels almost like something you would say, you know, something that sounds like self-effacing, but really. Yeah. And then you actually do it, you're like, oh no, it turns out that is actually.
It actually works, yeah. So anyone out there, stop trying.
Yeah. Stop trying to please anyone but yourselves. So I guess
stop trying.
Within reason.
Yeah. Come on out.
Like, don't go weird with it.
Don't get weird on it. Just know you'll always have that sort of, like, you know, it'll be all right. And like I say, do you have that kind of like goal in mind for you? Or is it very much just like, do you know what? We're like enjoying kind of this like natural kind of like growth and everything that's happening. Like, do you kind of have that in mind? I guess, do you have that more so, I guess, now that songs are out and like seeing the shows as well? Because that obviously must help kind of like drive that as well.
But sure.
I think we're definitely trying to be like flexible with it and just like do what comes to us naturally. I think we definitely, like, we've always wanted to work on an album, so that's the goal.
Yeah.
We're just getting there in like a really roundabout way.
It's also hard when you do have something like Home, when it goes crazy. It's like, it skews everyone's perspective.
Yeah,
so,
of
like,
course. Yeah,
we almost
have
to like forget about it. That was like the keys in the engine. And then like, from Keep It Up onwards, it's kind of like, that's rational. Otherwise, it would be insane.
You're like, honestly, please. Like
if everything was Home, it would be ridiculous right now. So it's quite nice that it's like, we almost start from day dot again.
Yeah. With that foundation, I guess,
get a normal trajectory going, which is cool.
With the knowledge that if a gig's ever going badly, you just whip out Home.
Whip it out. Just give them play it six times.
Yeah, that's it. Just gig, all you see is just like, we're just gonna keep playing this.
Do you want the whistle one?
And off it goes. Speaking of Keep It Up, we're gonna play Keep It Up right now.
And we're back.
Wow. Yes, you can tell. You know, we're sat here listening to it. It's just like it was in the room with us at the same time. Because, of course, this is Down With Boring, and because we ask the hard-hitting questions at all times, we're going to play a game now.
Fantastic.
And Jake, do you want to explain what this game is?
I would love to. It's going to be like Paxman on News Night. Your band is, I'm not sure if you know this, called Good Neighbours.
Good to know.
That's what we've heard.
We play a game on this. Sometimes they're really hard to come up with, but you've made it quite easy for us. So we're going to be playing Good Neighbours or Neighbours from Hell. So we're going to give you a couple of options, and you tell us which one you think would be a better neighbour to have.
Fantastic.
So it starts off, would you rather live next door to Fred Flintstone or Scooby-Doo?
Oh,
I think Fred Flintstone, because Scooby-Doo, if he's doing that Scooby-Doo-Doo at least three times a day.
Only three? I think he does like three times an episode. They're only
like
10 minutes long.
If he's constantly solving mysteries, that's going to do my head in.
Although it could be useful if you ever have like a dodgy, like if you live in a block of flats and you get a dodgy letting agent or whatever, he's going to be solving that mystery. I don't know what the mystery is.
Fred Flintstone's going to be a nightmare with on-street parking because he's
got... That's true.
He's not moving that car easily.
Plus all of his like home appliances are run by animals and things, which is a bit weird, isn't it?
It's not an easy question. I'd go Flintstone. Yeah.
You want to live next door to Flintstone?
Why not?
My pet dinosaur. That's pretty cool, isn't it?
That's true.
I'd like to share a wardrobe as well with Fred Flintstone.
Yeah, that would work.
I'm not sure if you're familiar with what neighbours do.
I don't know who you live next to, but just like a tree. Yeah,
it's how we work.
Yeah, that's it. I also love that on Scooby-Doo, your version is like solving mysteries, so you might be a bit of a Snoopy sort of like neighbour. Looking in like,
that's a different dog.
Nice.
With that in mind.
Zing.
We're sharp today. Here's the next one for you. Bleachers, full band, or Bruce Springsteen with the E Street Band. So two very big houses.
I think Bruce Springsteen's got a noisier scream.
He has, but also he really feels like he would invite you around for a nice cooked dinner.
Ooh.
Him and a Sunday roast would make so much sense.
I feel
sense.
Like it would be like, you know, like when a cockerel goes at dawn, but he just opens the window at 6 a.m. and goes, is anybody alive out there?
Do you want that every morning?
I feel like they'd be nice neighbours.
Yeah.
And you could probably go and play pool with them.
I mean, either way, you're living in a good neighbourhood if you're next to
Yeah, there's
of
no
them,
neighbours
so.
From hell there.
Yeah, just to put it out there, I do love bleachers, but just maybe not as neighbours.
I also like the idea that every morning, Bruce Springsteen would start playing 10th Avenue Freeze Out. That's just how he starts his day.
He doesn't switch
off. How do you think he's so tight on stage?
Yeah, he's the boss.
He does it all the time. A strong choice.
An ostrich or a grizzly bear?
That seems too obvious.
Does it?
You identify as an ostrich.
You identify as a bear.
Yeah. I would say ostrich would annoy me with the fence situation. Like if you're having a barbecue.
Yeah, always peeking over. Always.
Like the fresh eggs, though.
Fresh eggs, yeah. Big eggs
That's
as well.
Good.
That's at least
but
a week
with
eggs.
A grizzly bear all winter. You don't have to worry about him. He's asleep,
isn't he? I think winter. Would you, summer or winter? I think I'm going to go bear.
I'd go ostrich. What do we do here?
Not that obvious, is it? I don't know. I think you
I'll
have to break up the band.
But once.
I guess.
Yeah, nice.
That makes sense.
Break up. Yeah, that's it. That's the end. That's what drove a wedge between good neighbours. It's like, I just simply can't come back from this.
Yeah, that's
like,
crazy.
For me, that is like one of the goals I want to achieve with this podcast is to accidentally like
split a band.
See a band 2 years later. And they're like, yeah, that was actually the beginning of the end for us.
Yeah,
I think.
Thanks, man.
The ostrich grizzly bear thing.
It was the
not
nucleus.
You guys. Not you.
Not you. Somebody else. Dalai Lama or Ainsley Harriet?
Oh, Ainsley.
Bam. Straight in.
Wait, you'd go Dalai Lama?
Never met the Dalai Lama or Ainsley Harriet.
Love Ainsley Harriet.
Yeah.
He's
free dinners.
I reckon he's a racket.
He is definitely a racket.
Yeah.
He can't help it.
He's
an exuberant guy.
Voice. Yeah. But he would cook banging food. He's at least doing one barbecue a year where you can go over.
Oh, yeah, that's good. He's definitely serving
Dalai over Lama's the fence. Not giving barbecue vibes.
He's not giving
true.
You much, is he?
Plus, imagine looking out the window in the morning, you look down and you see Ainsley's kitchen. He's in there just sauteing away.
Yeah.
That's a good start to the day.
That's what
it?
I'm saying.
Yeah.
Also, would the Dalai Lama be like annoyed at noise? I feel like he kind of wants peace.
I would feel like
chill.
We'd be a burden on the Dalai Lama. And I don't want that
and
for
that's
my soul.
The headline, everybody.
Good neighbors burden the Dalai Lama.
Burdening the Dalai Lama. A very clear one.
Everyone's been saying it.
Yeah, everyone's been talking about it.
That's so true. You know the Dalai Lama's got an album?
Has he?
Yeah, it's like some chanting. But he released it and it came up on New Music Friday, which was one of the most enjoyable.
No way.
Yeah. It came up like albums out today and I was like,
what? I'd love to see the pitch for that. It must be insane.
Who's doing the PR? Yeah. Who's sending out the album?
Yeah.
Johnny Cash or Elvis Presley alive? before. Normally, when we say things like this, people go, "What now?"
I don't feel educated on either of them enough.
I'd go Elvis just to be easy. But then watching the Elvis film, I don't know. He didn't come out great in that film.
He's an intense guy, yeah.
But also, are we living in America? He never left America, did he?
Yeah, I guess so. I mean, maybe
in the UK,
if he's alive,
no
maybe he came over. Maybe, you know. So he faked his death and he moved to England and lives next door to you.
He's really fat.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, the funny thing I know about him is his ridiculous, what was it, breakfast routine that he used to have?
That is such a great only thing to know. listening to Hound Dog, like, no, I never heard this before.
What point can he eat?
Do you sing?
Hey, this is by Elvis. The peanut butter.
Big boy. Next door. Maybe we go Johnny Cash just.
Yeah, because
why not?
Because Elvis seems
Elvis
too intense.
Elvis just put us off, I think. I think we just put ourselves off.
Yeah. We've put ourselves off Elvis.
Him out. Yeah,
we'll get through it.
He's probably lovely.
Get really deep here. The moon or the sun?
Sun.
Wow. Yes. Ooh. Sun.
Yeah. But you can just get blackout blinds. You can't. You can't make the sun happen, can you?
You can't.
Think about it.
True. Yeah, think about it.
Ask people in Finland. They hate it in winter.
Think about it. The moon also. The moon has something to do with tidal waves, doesn't it?
Well, just with tides.
With tides. There you go. Yeah.
Only tidal waves. All other waves.
The tide. Yeah.
Yeah. The way.
Pray we're not living by the coast.
Yeah. Basically.
No, I'm going sun.
Sun.
It's a solid sun.
You wouldn't want to be in the bath with a fucking tide going, would you?
All the time.
That moon's next door.
Chill out.
Marching band or a samba collective?
Oh, samba.
Yeah, samba, yeah.
All
yeah.
day.
Yeah. Yeah. Not
really good
there.
For my keepy uppies as well in the garden, having a samba.
Oh, right, sort of nice backbeat.
Back jogger Benito, yeah, it'd be beautiful.
That's good. It would make every day would feel. I was like, well, if the sun's next door, it would be every day summer. But every day feel like summer with the Samba Collective.
That would be good neighbours, having the sun one side and Samba on the other.
Yeah.
It'd literally just every day is summer.
That's it. Next time we see you, you'd be bronzed, chilled out, board shorts.
Yeah, 100%.
Or burn to a crisp from.
I think I'd probably go, Benidorm burn. That'd be where
I'd
be.
I mean, if you're that close to the sun, I think.
Yeah, you can't help
you've
it.
Gone,
you're only human.
You've got no choice at that point, yeah.
A very strong one. And a last one for you. This is the one that we've been waiting to know about. The monkey from Coco Pops or.
I forgot about him.
Tony the Tiger off of Frosties.
I'd take Tony the Tiger.
Would you?
Yeah.
He's.
Again,
bit loud, though. He's a bit much.
He's so much.
Yeah.
He's a cuddly guy.
Yeah.
I think you kind of give the Coco Pops guy again. Do you not think so in human form?
Like gangly.
That would actually be a really good fancy dress.
Yeah, just like running around, just like.
You basically have the hat on now.
Yes.
If you live next door to him and you're going to a fancy dress party, he goes, oh, who are you dressed as? And you're there like, you.
Yeah, that is awkward.
That would be
Tony
really,
the Tiger just
really uncomfortable.
That everything's great would be really annoying.
Yeah, also, I bet he loves talking about swimming a lot, doesn't he? Off the Frosty's
badges. He could teach you, couldn't he? He sponsored the badges. Mm. Come on. Swim coach?
Yeah, is it worth living next to him for the swimming, though?
I think we're going to divide opinion here. I'm going Coco Pops.
On reflection, I'm going Coco Pops.
Oh, okay, fair.
Okay, strong for the Coco
Sack
Pops
off
guy.
Tony.
Yeah, he'd be a nice guy. Also, great breakfast.
Yeah.
Easy. You'll have a wonderful time. You've got no qualms against it.
Yeah, true.
With the knowledge of living next to the monkey from Coco Pops in mind. Good neighbours, it's been a pleasure.
Thank you for having us.
Thanks for coming down. Thanks for really diving into the serious topics.
I'm glad we got it out the
and
way.
We now know if there's any estate agents listening, you know what to look for.
Yeah.
It's been decided in
Thank
very
you.
Form. We're going to play Home. Because you
Classic.
Do only have two tracks out and we have to play two songs. So
that makes sense.
That makes sense.
It was a 50-50.
It was going to be that. Good neighbours, thank you very much, guys.
Thank you very much, guys.
Thanks for having us.
There go Good Neighbours.
And the best neighbours you'll ever have.
And they have become good friends. That's right. Yeah. That's right.
I'm never going to get tired of using that joke, I don't think.
I don't think.
Everyone else is, but I'm not.
Well, we got a real understanding of, you know, who they'd like to, you know, live alongside now. So now I feel like we have actually probably got to the heartbeat of both of Good Neighbours. So
thank God.
Thank God.
Speaking of getting to the heart of things, should we do some perfunctory comments about some songs that we've enjoyed over the past 2 weeks?
Do you know what? I reckon we should do that, Jake. Shall I kick things off with a new song?
I would love to hear from Lava La Rue what you've been listening to.
Well, I've been listening to Lava La Rue. Who has dropped a brand new song called Love Bites. So we've heard about Lava La Rue's debut album coming up, Starface. Really excited. Obviously, former Dork cover star. Just love everything that Lava La Rue, I guess, just done over the past few years. It's always felt like they've been a little bit like outside of any sort of like scene or maybe expectation. Like every single release has been like completely flipped on what's come before. And this kind of like clash of all sorts of styles. And I think it comes across so well on something like Love Bites. Because we had obviously Push and Shove, which was a bit more, I guess, like funky, poppy, a bit more slick in that vein. Humanity felt a little bit more, I don't know, like underground indie sort of like, you know, some, that more like South London-esque sort of scene. And this kind of feels like just this real fuzzy indie pop vibe with these clattering drums which all bounce together, and like I just think it's like truly creating a path of their own is kind of everything that Lava La Rue has been about. And I think the challenge that Lava La Rue probably had has been like, right, with this debut album, how do I kind of make a succinct statement, I guess?
This is what I was going to say, like, how do you kind of knit all of that together?
That's what I
really enjoy about Lava La Rue's stuff is, like, as you say, it kind of feels to sit outside of any scenes and stuff that's going on at the moment. So it does, I always find it interesting when they do release a new track, because you kind of never know what you're going to get. And I really like this new one.
Yeah, it kind of like, it makes it definitely like far more exciting. And I think everything that they've done obviously is part of 9-8 Collective and that kind of, you know, real, you know, scene of people that's kind of creating all these slightly different takes on genres that I think you might know. It's a real wonderful combination. And I think it comes across maybe the best on Love Bites in terms of just that world of sound and noise. And it just makes me think, right, this album out 19th of July, this could contain anything. And this kind of whole mix
That's what it makes you think. You think to yourself, wow, this album coming out 19th of July could contain anything.
Yes.
You think that. You think in terms of release dates in your head.
Yeah, that's it. How do you think I keep track of my life? I'm purely on release dates.
Wow, this album coming out 19th of July.
Wow,
what a normal thought to have.
What a normal time. Whilst I get my diary out and write the rest of the dates coming up for any single drops that are coming up.
The rest of the dates,
all of them.
That's not a diary, that's just a piece of paper.
It's actually a napkin, Jake, I think you'll find. I'm much more classy than that. This is Love Bites by Lava La Rue. Great stuff.
Great stuff indeed.
Jake, what have you got? What have you
I've got one, yeah. I've got a song.
Yeah, go on in.
I saw these guys the other day, and it really clicked for me, I think, in a way that I hadn't before. But this, I've got a new track from Cardinals. They're from Cork in Ireland. They've got a kind of Smashing Pumpkins-y, REM-y sound. I was thinking about this. I don't know whether we have spoken about them before on the show or whether we've just spoken about them before.
Cardinals. I think, in person we definitely have, I feel. But I don't think we've actually chatted about them on the show.
I'm not sure where we spoke about when their debut came out. Anyway, I really like this song.
Yeah.
And seeing them live really clicked for me. I think they're really, really good live, and it kind of all, I don't know, it all works really well live. And then I listened to this song, which has just come out, and I think this really works as well. So I think they've really hit their stride, basically. I'm also quite like it because it's under 2 minutes long. And then you read about it. You read about it, and they say the reason it's under 2 minutes long is because they've been listening to loads of Buddy Holly.
Yeah.
And a load of his songs are really short. And I really rate a band that sounds so like Smashing Pumpkinsy listening to Buddy Holly and being like, yeah, I reckon we could do that.
Yeah. I mean, that kind of actually summarizes why maybe, like, you know, like you say, we've kind of seen them before in various places, and like that sort of, they have this like undercurrent of like a band who, like, probably unfairly will be like, oh, you're part of this kind of world, you're going to sound kind of like this, when actually this kind of depth that they have is always kind of like, oh, okay, no, there is something else here that's going on. And I think this is the track which, for me anyway, has definitely been like, right, here we are. Like, this is like the band stepping forward and going, this is where we're different, this is where we stand out. And yeah, under 2 minutes, absolutely love this. It just like immediately is like pulls you in. And yeah, I'm looking forward to all of it that comes up. They've got I think a debut EP coming out 7th of June.
They have indeed. Yes. See, did you think about that?
Dates. I'm thinking about it. Don't you worry.
Yeah, that's up by So Young, who obviously have their own little record label now and has some really good stuff on it.
Yeah.
I think like just in general, like from, I mean, when they've started out, like I've never seen a group of people with their finger more on the pulse with this kind of stuff. So I think
it's a good
their
sign.
Cosign is a valuable one.
Yes, it's a very good sign.
So yeah, really looking forward to the EP. Really like this. And if you get a chance, definitely see them live. This is 19 by Cardinals.
Shout out Cardinals. Not Young Cardinals, which was the song by Alexis on Fire. Little
not
fact for you.
Cardinals, the bird.
Mm. Yeah, we weren't about to play bird song.
We weren't. Have you got another song for us, Jamie?
I do.
Got anything for us?
Got a little something for you. Yep, I've got a little something for you. It's Flower of Love, who's got a brand new track called Boys. This is
not a Charlie XCX cover.
It's not. Yes, flag right now. Not a Charlie XCX cover. This is a first new music of the year, and what a fucking banger this is! Just like
it's good.
Huge,
it's good stuff.
Big pop energy. I think like when Flower of Love first came out, we obviously were like, "Oh wow, this is amazing," but I don't know. It's been quite amazing.
When she first came out, all I could think of was that song that's like, the power of love, but with the flower of love. So yeah, it took me a while to get that gone. I hope I've forced other people now to listen in that way.
To the power of love. Yeah, that's what we're actually going to play now. Huge tune. Yeah, and I think when she first came out, it's kind of like, okay, this artist's kind of like finding her feet. Slightly kind of like, I don't know, like a little bit like quieter, but like that's the kind of like world that it is. And just the change in the past like year has been amazing, and has kind of just gone about it without like just very subtly going about it. So like Next Best Exit, really like this really cool, almost like, I don't know, like electronic-y kind of like, you know, zippy kind of like hit. And A Girl Like Me, obviously, as well, is really great. But this feels like the most direct that we've heard Flower of Love. And I love the fact that it's just a pop smash. Like, it's just immediately in your head. It's so catchy. It's really, like, in focus. And I think it kind of just signals that, like, okay, like, the ambition of Flower of Love is suddenly like, oh, no, it's not just like, oh, I'm going to put this out and, you know, connect with people. It's going to be that, and it's going to be, I can go bigger than that. I can reach bigger than that. I can do more. And this is the sort of song that leads it.
There was obviously a massive, massive fan base pretty much immediately.
Yeah.
But I think it's just moving beyond that kind of cultiness to it, and sort of making a real grab for like genuine mainstream appeal. And I think it fucking smashed it, to be honest.
It's an absolute big tune. Made for summer. Made for the beach. Made for cocktails.
Beach.
Made for...
You're down the beach with it, are you? With the girlies?
Yeah. Got like the boombox on my shoulder as I'm blaring this song out loud, you know. Because that's
great.
What you do. That's what you do. Because I'm cool like that, Jake. I don't know if you know. I'm just that guy. I bring the vibes, and the vibes.
I hate this so much.
This song, this is Boys by Flower of Love.
A lot happened at the end there. I don't really want to think about it.
I just kind of fell apart, I'll be honest with you. But the summer's here, that's why. We're looking ahead. We've got so much more to come in the summer.
It's like 17 degrees outside. The summer's here.
Everybody ready? We are go.
Yeah.
Yeah. One more.
Speaking of things that go.
Yes.
Amyl and the Sniffers are back. Yes. Which is confirmed good news. I say back, they're back with new music. They've never really stopped playing.
I was about to say, I don't think there's actually...
I've always been surprised with Amyl and the Sniffers how I think they're one of those bands that like you listen to and you're like, I really like this, but it doesn't really have much major appeal. But I think everyone that listens to them has the same response. Yeah. So they actually have a very big appeal. Like every time I've seen them, and weirdly, like we've seen them at Flow Festival in Helsinki.
Yep.
And we've also seen them in Iceland, and both times they've had an absolutely huge crowd.
Massive crowd.
Which is great. Honestly, like, no one deserves it more than them. They are absolutely great. But I think new music for them is good, because seeing them live, like, multiple times, always good fun. But that second album was so different to the first one that it felt like there was so much room to grow there.
Yeah, completely.
And now there's a new song out.
Mm. I think that's
called You Should Not Be Doing That.
Oh.
Yeah. It's basically just about like Amy, the front woman, just, you know, being in the music industry, being in a band, just having a load of old blokes telling her that she shouldn't be doing various things that she enjoys doing and telling them to fuck off. Mm. So, yeah, that's nice, I think.
Yeah.
As she says, it's a way of rubbing the dog's nose in its own dog piss after it weed on your favorite rug or something.
That right there captures why Amyl the Sniffers are so great. I mean, they're just so like they're such an incredible live band, and I feel like it's one of those where if you go and see them, you'll be like, right, when can I go and see them again? It's kind of one of those bands 100%. Who immediately you're kind of hooked and stuff, and like it's right here is this very direct in your face but like just very like welcoming as well kind of like take on I guess kind of punk that kind of brings people in, and it's like great to hear that keep developing and developing musically before they step out on stage and obviously smash it. Like I think they're playing with like Foo Fighters this summer in like stadiums. Crazy
mental. And I think like first time I saw them was 2018 at the Great Escape. And then I saw them in Lexington a few days later because they were so good.
Yeah.
And it was like, wow, this is such like a great, like sweaty, like pub band.
Yeah.
And then I saw them, I've seen them since then at festivals where they haven't been playing in tents. They've been playing like main stage stuff. And it's like, somehow this translates. I think like just the energy that they all give means it does. But like, it's kind of mad to listen to that first album on record and then see it live in like say a stadium setting and be like, yeah, I didn't really expect this to actually translate here, and it somehow does.
Yeah, you can,
very much looking forward to seeing them again, but actually with some new material this time as well.
It's also quite good that they've become a band where it's like, oh, you know, this band, you know, you have to kind of play probably, you know, the kind of punk or like rocky festivals. It's like, no, they can cross over and play anything and walk away with so many more fans. Like, it's truly amazing. And like to see that develop is brilliant. And this track is another example of just how great it's going.
This is You Should Not Be Doing That by Amyl and the Sniffers. And you told me that I should not be doing that. Hey, I was in LA taking my shift while you were down in Melbourne saying fuck that bitch. You're in New York getting shit on, and they were down in Melbourne saying you should not be doing that.
You should not be doing that as just like a very cutting way to stop someone doing something, I feel, is also quite good, isn't it? It's like, oh, you should not be doing that. Like, what are you doing over
there? Yeah,
You should not be doing that.
I mean, the point of the song is that people that say that should fuck off. But yeah, sure. Why not?
They should. Albums.
Should we talk about some albums?
A busy few weeks with albums. So we're gonna throw back to an album that came out a couple of weeks back, I guess, when you listen to this, and then obviously an album that's just prime and ready out this week. So we'll start with small emerging pop star Billie Eilish. Jake, I don't know if you've heard of Billie Eilish, who is back with third album, which is called Hit Me Hard and Soft.
It's called what? Sorry?
Hit Me Hard and Soft is what it's...
It's not called Hit Me Hard and Soft, as you just said.
Hit Me Hard and Soft.
Just want to flag, before we talk about this, I've really enjoyed... there's a very good review in The Guardian. Mm. So I do want to say that. It's a good review.
Yeah.
But I just... The opener, it says... It finds the former teen prodigy, now 22. It's like, that is how aging works. Yes. That is how it goes. I think it's just like you know, talking about someone who released the first time when they're 18 in 30 years' time. Like, the former teen prodigy, now 50.
Former does make it sound like, you know, oh, well, they've decided not to be that anymore. You know, or they aren't allowed to be that anymore.
They decided to reach their 20s.
Yeah. They made a decision to move away from being a teenager and have now moved into the idea of being older than that.
Anyway,
yes.
For context, I loved Billie Eilish's first album.
Yeah.
And I didn't really vibe with the second one, aside from a couple of tracks. So I'm one all here.
Yeah.
The third one, as the name may imply, it's kind of a mix of the two, and it works a lot better for me. I think having the kind of weird, like almost horror movie stuff from the first one in there really counterbalances some of the slower ones and makes me enjoy them more. So I think Billie smashed it.
I mean, if you think as well about what Billie, you know, like kind of even, you know, as a third album, but in between all of these albums, you've had, you know, the Bond theme, you've had obviously the Barbie like soundtrack, and, you know, scooping all the awards there. And you've kind of seen probably that more, I guess, like quiet and reserved Billie Eilish, which is kind of where it kind of, I don't know, really kind of came from. It was coming from a place of quite vulnerable, like tender emotion. And kind of as like built from there in terms of all the like sound and production that came on that first album. The second album, I'm kind of with you on that. There was a lot of good on it, and there's a lot of like absolute bangers. But there was, you know, some stuff. It was like, oh, I'm not really sure. Like, it's kind of moving on from one album to the next. Not, it's, you know, it's like, okay, that's it's cool, it's great, and exactly what she needed. But me, it's not the, maybe as one. Yeah.
For me, the danger with it and what I was worried about was, if you do, I mean, you get famous that early or whatever, and you get big, it's very hard to stick the landing. And I think there is a danger that you see doing like slower, more kind of ballady songs as a mature approach. And just kind of keep going into that and lose a lot of what was on that first album.
Yeah.
And I think like some of Billie's like ballady stuff works really well for me. I think the Barbie song, What Was I Made For, is great. And I think some of the stuff on the second album is good, but I think some of it was just a bit boring. So it's very good to see her completely stick the landing on the third one and be like, I can do that, but I can also do the like more fast paced stuff, and it doesn't detract from like me, myself as a serious artist, I think is the big thing for me. The realization has hit that you don't have to be, you know, mature in a kind of like, you know, boring middle-aged way.
Maturing doesn't mean, oh, you've just got to like calm down and go a bit quieter. Like, it's like, exactly. No, it's like that. And that's probably a really good way to summarize this album. Like, I really love this album. I really like, I mean, my always the one, and this was just more of like a personal taste thing than anything, was that sometimes with Billie stuff, it was like, okay, he's still that kind of quite low sort of vibey feel, and don't get me wrong, like absolutely great, but after a while maybe it was like, okay, like is there somewhere else we can go with this? And like, this is the album for me that does that. Like the way that they push kind of like sound into like, you know, dance electronic breakdowns and like huge swirling production around stuff and making just like really big pop music, like big tunes and like massive songs. Like, you know, some of the stuff on there, like, you know, like Lunch or like Birds of a Feather, like are for me are some of the best tunes. Like, it really does feel like a massive album from an artist who's kind of like, I don't know, just like leaning into the fact, like, okay, I can do whatever I want now. Let me really spread my wings and kind of go for it in that sense. And for that, I think it is her best album. I think anyway, it really stands out to me. And I think, yeah, there'll always be that affinity to the debut album because it came at that almost that perfect time and to usher in almost, I guess, the next generation of artists making that kind of music. But for me, this is where that maturity, like you were saying, is shown, and it's shown in a big, big way. It's really a fun album, one that kind of feels, I mean, I don't know if you remember, we watched Billy obviously headline Reading and Leeds. Was it last year?
Don't know if you remember that. I don't know if you remember that we watched Billy headline Reading and Leeds. I do remember that.
Yeah,
actually,
was it last
Jamie?
Year?
Yes.
Was it last year, 2023? It was, wasn't it?
Yeah. It was indeed.
It was, obviously,
I don't know if you remember it, actually, Jamie.
Clearly, by the sounds of it, I don't. Like, an amazing, like, set and really, really great. But there were times you were like, oh, yeah, like, her music is quite low at times in terms of just the sounds that's going out. So, like, this feels like an album made for those bigger stages.
I thought quite interesting in how much it didn't kind of lack energy despite being on that second album tour. It almost felt to me like she had purposefully, like, almost done a third album version of the set where it was like a real decent mix of stuff. I really liked that. Thought it was good. We've got another album to talk about. So this is Lunch by Billie Eilish.
Wonderful stuff. Billie Eilish.
Second album.
Another album for you. This time, let's go to friends of the show, Jake. Wallows.
Of course.
Who are back with their brand new album called Model. Another third album for you here. I guess, like, everyone needs... Wallows, for me, are really, like, interesting story, really. They kind of, like, starting out as this band, like you say, very, like, US kind of, like, influence and feel, but with that sort of British, I don't know, there's, like, you know, the same way, like, the Killers, where it's like, oh, they feel like slightly British in a way because their sensibilities and their influences kind of lean towards other British bands or things like that. They kind of always, I don't know, for me, have, like, felt a little bit like that. They've leaned into that sort of, like, you know, Smiths-esque era of, like, songwriting or, like, that sort of world of things where they've kind of, like, you know, tied into that sort of, like, I guess, remnants of, like, post-punk and elements of it and all tied in together. But this is, as a third album, for me, is kind of where, I know, they evolve again. We were talking about Billy kind of, like, maturing.
They feel very, like, Magpie-like to me as a band. I think they're very capable of switching up and just, like, finding things they like in everything. I think this album, to me, I was listening to it earlier, there is a, you know, there's bits on it that sound almost a bit like Radiohead, and then there's other bits that genuinely seem very, like, Strokes influenced.
Yeah.
Which to me, like, I really enjoy, I think, in a world where everyone can listen to everything, I mean, if you have the capability and the talent to be able to switch between these things, like, it absolutely makes sense to do it. And I think, as you say, it makes sense, it makes sense for them to do it, but also it does almost feel, I don't know, it does feel quite British in a way to be like, there's a lot of these bands that they're kind of emulating that, I mean, I can't speak to the American scene because I'm not American, but bands in, like, the post-punk world and stuff like that in Britain have always taken as, like, their touch points, and Wallows are almost like, yeah, here they all are. Like,
yeah, exactly. They condense it in a way that's just, like, perfect, and they serve it in such a, like efficient feels like a really shit word for it, but, like, it is...
Don't use it then.
It is... It rhymes with coefficient. That's what they are.
Got him.
They'll never know. But it just feels so, like, razor sharp, perfect. And I think what they've grown from as a band is this ability to be like, right, we know who we are as a band, and this is how we can evolve it without it feeling too completely out of left field. There's probably, this feels
there's
like
a lot,
such
I think
a great
there's
album.
A lot of musical confidence on this album.
100%.
And I think that's what allows them to pull it off, is there's no worry from them that by taking inspiration from kind of one, like if you're listening to one song and they take a load of inspiration from one other band, a lot of bands would be worried like, oh, can we pull this off? Will it sound like a pastiche? Will it sound like this? But I think by like kind of wearing their influences on their sleeve and really laser focusing on that, it comes out as a stronger album. And I think they've nailed it, because it's still, when you listen to it, you're like, this is definitely Wallows. This is a Wallows album. This all works together. And that, I think, is the rub, is if you do it and it doesn't sound like a coherent whole, like, you know, you can end up sounding a bit like a covers band, and they've avoided that.
Yeah. 100%. There's that confidence there more so than ever. And like, I mean, hearing tracks like Only Ecstasy, and you can feel, you know, like you say, this kind of like, you know, freedom to kind of play around with kind of like what they are. Which is really, really fun. And at the core of it is really a band who are like made for people to, I don't know, go to the shows and like scream along to every lyric and be that band that, you know, really represent that and write in that manner where it feels like they've been writing in like a scrapbook all these years and been like, you know, here's all of our thoughts. And it's like such a universal thought that it connects so well. And this album's brilliant. And it just continues, I think, to cement the, like what we've kind of known for a while now, which is just Wallows are made like very like, subtly and under the radar, just a band who are just absolutely smashing it and doing an incredible job at it. I mean, we saw them at Reading and Leeds last year, how big that crowd was and how they really owned it. So this is an album that's going to just cement that and build on it. So a really, really great one. If you're looking for an album that you can just dive into and immediately be there and just, you know, connect to, this is one. Like, I'd recommend everyone click play and hear what comes of it. We're gonna play.
I recommend everyone spin it on their vinyl player.
Of course. Do people scratch vinyls anymore? Is that a thing?
Grandmaster Flash is still going. I don't know if any young people do.
He must ruin his vinyls by doing that, though, innit? Like, God, be a nightmare.
Oh, you're going to upset people calling them vinyls.
All right, well, this is Only Ecstasy by Wallows, and I'll go and deal with the mob outside right now. Don't apologize for crying. I will always hold you space. Beyond your falling tears, I can see generations in your face. I see the eyes of unborn daughters. I see you on that deathbed too. Not long before or after me, cause I don't wanna. Good stuff.
Jamie has avoided being lynched by the Six Music Dads.
I managed to run away.
The plural of vinyl is vinyl.
It turns out I can run. I can run quicker.
We're back for Tweets of the Week.
We certainly are. What has been going on social media? It's what we ask every single time we do this. And as the last one for a while. Yeah.
Often the answer is not much.
I know. But this week, we've got some for you. We've got a couple. Should I start, Jake, with our first one?
Yeah, go on.
Let's go over to a former Dork cover star and met like probably like I guess one of the biggest artists on the planet right at this moment.
Something like that. Yeah, it's gotta be up there.
Sabrina Carpenter. This is a quote tweet, if you will. So if we start with that, which is obviously Espresso has been a massive tune. Adele has talked about it, and Adele was quoted at a recent Las Vegas show saying, as I got into bed last night, because it was a very late night for me, I found myself singing, I'm working late because I'm a singer, that Sabrina Carpenter song. That song is my jam. And Sabrina Carpenter has quote tweeted and said, all I read was Adele thinks about me in bed.
Strong.
Strong takeaway. What songs do you listen to when you go to bed? Or what songs do you think about?
Well, I haven't, like, if I'm coming home from anywhere and I know I'm going to go to bed straight away, I have a bit of a worry that when I'm listening to stuff, I'm like, is this going to keep me awake? Because, like, are you meant to blast yourself with sound immediately before trying to become unconscious?
It's a fair point.
So I get a bit paranoid about it, actually, in like quite a absurd way. So I often don't listen to music for the last like 15 minutes of the journey, just in case.
To switch it off.
Any scientists listening, if you could tell me whether that's a good or a bad idea, or doesn't make any sense, or does,
but do
let
you,
me know.
Do you like turn the like, so I guess, vibe down? Like, do you like maybe if you're going from like, I don't know, if you're playing Darude Sandstorm, for example, as you're sitting on the way back home on the bus, which I'm sure you do quite a lot, that would make sense.
I'll tell you what a classic one for me is actually Nebraska by Bruce Springsteen, because it's quite mellow and quiet. I feel it's almost like a lullaby, isn't it? Except it's a lullaby about a man being like blown up with a bomb.
Oh boy! I'm 20 minutes from home.
Modern music. I'm not listening to new stuff on my way home.
No,
because what if it makes me feel something? I can't be feeling things before bed.
And then you're sat there looking at the ceiling, like panicking.
Or you get halfway through a new album, you're like, "This is incredible," and you're like, "But I've got to go to bed now."
Yeah.
So it's actually quite a fraught area for me.
I've brought up some trauma. Yeah.
What about you, Jamie?
I listen to the Grease soundtrack. And it slowly winds me to bed. And usually I go to bed. I usually fall asleep just at the moment when Sandy is kicking in.
Not Beauty's Called Dropout.
Boom, 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 boom. Not that one. No.
No, not that one.
By the way, have you seen Frankie Valli lately? Jesus Christ. He's fucked, mate. He's done.
Is he alive?
He's still alive, mate. He's still playing shows. He's doing gigs.
That's a bit mental.
Like, but there's a lot of videos of him playing where it, he's 90. Like, fair fucks to the guy.
Yeah, you're saying, have you seen the state of him? The fact that he's still alive, like, the state is good. Like, what are you talking about,
Jamie? No, he's not good. Look, he's not good. Like, if you go look like...
He's better than most 90-year-olds who are dead.
Well, go and look at the videos afterwards. It's not great, mate. Like, he's
better than a dead person.
I suppose, yeah, but...
Why is he touring? He's 90. Like, sit down, man.
He has made more money than I will ever make in my life. And I can't really explain.
What do you think Frankie Valli's bio is on Twitter? he names himself as three things. There are three identifying things. So he says X, Y, and Z, touring now.
Oh, no. Hits, swagger, drugs. There we go. Frankie Valli.
Not quite as good as that. He says, legendary singer.
Yep.
Inspiration for the hit musical Jersey Boys.
Yeah.
And family man.
Oh. That's quite nice.
Feels like inspiration for the hit musical Jersey Boys is quite sort of specific compared to the other two.
Yeah.
You know, like, I'm a lover, I'm a semi-professional bowling player, and I'm a family man. One of those is not like the others, Frankie Valli. Anyway, kind of got off topic a bit here.
Yeah, this is Espresso. This is Espresso by Sabrina Carpenter. Play. Now he's thinking about me every night. Oh, is it that sweet? I guess so. Say you can't sleep, baby, I know. What's that mean? Espresso. Move it up, down, left, right, oh. Switch it up like Nintendo. Say you can't sleep, baby, I know. What's that mean? Espresso. Think about me every night. Oh, is it that sweet? I guess so. Say you can't sleep, baby, I know. What's that mean? I wonder if Frankie Valli is working late because he is a singer.
Working later than most 90-year-olds who are dead.
Exactly, yeah. Out of the 90-year-olds, he's working latest. That's definitely that.
Exactly. Charlie Bliss is our second tweet.
Yes.
Charlie Bliss taking a photo of Impossible Sausage Patties advert.
Ooh.
That says, it's giving Eat Me vibes.
Ooh.
And they've said...
Interesting.
Is that right? Is that what the vegan sausage patty is giving? Eat me vibes? I want to cover my body in moss and lay in the barren wilderness until the sky collapses. I agree.
Eat me vibes. It's giving. Mm. It's giving eat me vibes.
Words don't mean anything anymore, do they?
What? I mean, it's a bit much, is what I would say.
It's also such a weird way of saying, like, it's nice.
It's nice. It's tasty.
If someone actually said to me, like, oh, I've got a McDonald's and it was giving eat me vibes, you'd be like, why didn't you just say you ate a McDonald's?
Also, isn't that the point of all food? That it should give off eat me vibes?
Well, exactly. Like, it's kind of the bare minimum.
Like that's the, do you know what I mean? Like, that's
it's not
like,
even good.
That's
it's
the
just
simple.
Saying, like, it's edible.
Hey, it's food. Eat me, I guess. It's like having a, like an advert for water and it going, it's giving drink me. It's giving.
It's the same. It's the same as that, Jamie.
It's giving that. I don't like a kit. I also like the fact the QR code in the corner. I really am representing on this advert, which is I would argue who is scanning that?
Yeah. Also, it looks like it's on a tube, so you wouldn't have any internet connection anyway.
Yeah, exactly. You're underground, and all you can think of is it's giving eat me vibes.
It is giving eat me vibes.
It doesn't even look nice. I just want to flag as well that sausage patty.
It looks fine, doesn't it?
It's just a patty, isn't it?
I think the one thing with vegan, like, fake meat stuff that you shouldn't be drawing attention to is, like, what it looks like. Because, like, a lot of them do actually taste really nice. They taste absolutely fine. Some of them are, like, you can't really tell them apart. But saying it's giving eat me vibes, I'm like, well, not until you've eaten it and realized it tastes good.
Yeah. At that point, like, we're just scratching the surface. Basically, what you want to know is what the fuck is going on? And what
That's
is
true.
These vibes? Don't
that
worry.
Is
we
what I want to know.
Go and cover our bodies in moss and lay in the barren wilderness until the sky collapses.
I think so. This is 19 by Charlie Fliss.
Can I be honest? Push it all down, but I want you. Come on, honey, break my heart. I could run forever, but I won't get far. Sidewalks in the summer heat. Don't make a big thing about it.
And there we have it. Another week, another show for Down With Boring. Thank you to Good Neighbours for coming on. A pleasure.
For being good friends.
They certainly are now good friends. And we can keep using this joke because they haven't done that many interviews and therefore, you know, the worst is yet to come.
They said they weren't sick of it. I'm going to go and open my windows and see if I can hear Big Weekend from my flat.
Oh, that'd be nice.
Could be free music.
You could be hearing Danny Howard at this point. Or
yeah, I might wait an hour or two to open my windows actually.
Oh dear.
And on that note, bye.
Bye.